Welcome to this episode of Wine and Rations. Today we're going to be making yakisoba, one of the Army's most traditional dishes. Everybody knows yakisoba. People love that shit. Did you guys have yakisoba?
Oh yeah. Oh, we had yakisoba. I'm not going to say anybody loved it. We ate it. But I don't know.
That's
if
a good point.
We called it a chow hall. I know you guys are more of a defact type thing. You would have one option. So it doesn't matter if you loved it or not. If you loved it, you're having a great day. If you didn't love it, your choices were starve to death or eat the yakisoba.
So that's true. Let's be clearly honest. The whole point of the show is to let you guys know and inform you of what Army food is actually like and what Army cooks are actually like. Because if you didn't know, before I was a Green Beret, I was a 92 Golf, a food service specialist, which means I was cooking food for operators like fucking Andy Stumpf. And if Andy thought that I was in that kitchen all excited for the operators that were coming through eating that food and being proud of them and really putting my all into it, he would be dead wrong, because we don't give a shit. So, let's be honest. So that's what this show is all about. So we're gonna show them what it's like to actually cook, and I'm gonna make yakisoba for you guys.
And I'm gonna pair it with the best selection of alcoholic beverages on earth.
And if you guys don't know what yakisoba is a spaghetti meat fuck show. So basically, when you're a cook and you come into the kitchen, you're not all gung-ho and you're like, I'm gonna make the best fucking meal today. You're like, how do I get through this with my sanity so I can go drink my face off and pretend like I'm not a cook for a living in the military, which was a job that I didn't even know existed. So
did you know the menu the day before, or would you roll into work
and get told what you're making? No. So the sergeant typically dictates you like, hey, this is what you guys are making. Most of the time, the sergeant genuinely gets lazy though, and it's the same shit over and over and over. All right, so a little bit of butter, we'll get that going, and then we'll start getting the meat. Sautéing, we'll drain it, get that cooked down. The noodles are already cooked. We went and pre-cooked those so you guys didn't have to wait. But meanwhile, while I'm preparing these, I think some fans had some questions.
Yeah, fire away.
For you guys.
So from Trey Hughes, for special operations, if you could do one exercise excluding cardio, what would it be?
First of all, the fact that you're trying to avoid cardio says a lot about your dedication to
special
operations.
Or he's got a great cardio base.
All right. Glasses half full kind of guy.
I mean, I can tell you my least favorite exercise, which is a thruster, a front squat to an overhead press, and I hate it because it just hurts. But there's a cardio component to that, depending on how much weight you're actually carrying.
I think,
I don't know how to answer that, because there's no one, there's not a end-all, be-all exercise that's really going to prep you for that.
I think if I had to pick one, I would probably pick burpees.
I mean, you're gonna do a lot of them.
Which just sucks, right? Because nobody wants to just sit there and do burpees over and over and over and over again.
All right, so Buck's picking burpees, I'd pick thrusters. There you go.
All right, so real quick, I'm just slicing up these. Julienning, I think, is like a term that cooks use.
So do they teach this cutting technique in the Army chef school?
No. No, they did not. I mean, maybe they did for like a second, because let's be honest, and so it's a funny story how people don't know this. All right, we're about to I actually got a job in Los Angeles at a place called Street with this lady called named Susan Feniger. She had a restaurant called, it was called Street, and she was in Los Angeles. She was famous chef, she really well known. She was she had a show back in the day on Food Network called Hot Tamales.
Okay.
And I lied my ass off. I needed a job. I was struggling in Los Angeles. I had just gotten through a divorce. I was struggling and I needed a job. So this one came up in the ad. It was like, we need a cook, like a line cook, legitimate line cook for a legitimate chef.
I feel like you're qualified for both.
Right, so I was like, I can fucking do that. How hard is cooking gonna be? So I called my buddy, who's an actual chef in San Diego. He won some awards for like best young chef on the West Coast. He's phenomenal. He's an actual chef. That part looks gross.
It does.
If you were in the Army, I'd probably let you have that.
Yeah, I was going to say, in the defac, I feel like that's going in the
that's 100% going in, because I got 30 onions to do. Then I got time to worry about your feelings about black things, potentially dangerous, hazardous mold. That's on you. So I called up my buddy and I said, hey, dude, I got this interview for Susan Fenniger's restaurant. But she needs an experienced line cook, and I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. And he was like, Susan Fenniger? He's like, are you fucking kidding me? He's like, dude, she's a well-known chef. He goes, come down to San Diego, and I'll teach you some fancy cuts. And then you can go impress her when you have the job interview. So he taught me how to do, you know, cuts like this and, like, do my knuckles or whatever. So it looks like I knew what I was doing. And he goes, I'm going to tell you one thing. He goes, every time... they ask you, anytime you talk about anything, you're just gonna tell them, like, I'm obsessed with keeping my area clean. So I was like, all right, dude, I can do that. He goes, all you need to do is cut a certain way and just be like, I'm obsessed with cleanliness. They'll eat that shit out of the palm of your hand. So I did, and I fucking aced it, and I got the job. And the first day, the dude goes, hey, here, I need you to cut these onions. And I was like, I got this, dude. I was like, my buddy trained me. So I folded up these onions and I went, mah! And I cut the tip of my finger off. Within 5 minutes of being on the job, he knew I was lying my ass off. And that's how that went. So
did you keep the job?
I actually did keep the job. I think they had already overcommitted to me.
They were like,
fuck it, keep them. Any other questions, Kurt?
Yeah, so from Daly. The other wants to know, Sean, how do you think you would have done as a SEAL? Andy, how do you think you would have done as a Beret?
That's a great question, dude. I like that question.
I think it's easy, though. I think it would have been fine both directions.
No, sir, it would not have been fine both directions.
Do you not like the water?
Fuck no, I don't
know. Well, you would have probably struggled as a SEAL then.
Yeah.
If you had comfort in the water or you enjoyed the water, I think it would have been fine both directions. The water is a great equalizer, though.
That's a huge if, my dude. The water is terrible. So, yeah, I had somebody put me through a little bit of drown proofing.
Yeah.
Where they would, like, shove the hose in my mask.
That's not drown proofing.
What is that?
Drown proofing, the actual evolution, is hands tied together behind your back, feet tied together, bobbing up and down in the pool. Okay. Which I thought you guys did that as part of the Q course.
No. So not part of the Q course. So we have dive school.
Gotcha.
And you can go to dive school.
Yep.
Most of us opt not to because we're not psychopaths.
But then, I can support that decision.
Yeah, actually. The ones that are like really, you know, they like leather and pain and all
ball
that
chokes.
Shit. Yeah, they got
whips.
They shove things in their mouth. I'm sorry, guys. That's
Stiletto.
It's a good sadistic way that you do it. You go to dive school because you got some serious fucking hangers between your legs. So you could choose to do that. But so what is it when? All right, guys. So real quick, I'm adding the peppers to the onions. I'm adding the peppers and the onions to the meat, and I'm gonna let it cook until the peppers are soft. And then we're gonna add it to the noodles, add some seasoning, and then basically that's yakisoba is pretty much done.
How big is your frying pan in the defac? Like we're working at probably a one to two person serving size here. How are you doing this for a serving of soldiers coming in the afternoon? I mean, like, what size are we talking?
Yeah, and that's a great question, because it's not a pan. You're not you don't get the feeling that you're like cooking.
You guys just put like a propane burner under a dumpster.
Yeah, dude, it's like a huge bowl.
Cauldron.
Yes. It's like a cauldron, and you're just dumping like all this shit in there. So like any kind of consistency, fucking forget
God.
It. It's out the window. How it tastes that day. And honestly, I would say, you like that?
Mm-hmm.
You see that? Watch that.
I do that too.
Can seals do that?
Yep. Oh yeah.
You guys can do that.
We can do that.
You do water. You can do this.
Some Gordon Ramsay shit.
That's fucking Gordon like a motherfucker. What are we talking about?
Seals and green berets. Could you have been, how would it have gone if you were a seal, and how would it have gone if I was a green beret?
Yeah, so for me, the water is just, that's what I was gonna ask you. What is it called when they just put the hose in your mask, and they're just being dicks?
So I've never had anybody put a hose in my mask. I've had students go out and fill their mask up with salt water and then run around with it. We just call that fun as an instructor. It was a remediation tool. I don't know if I've ever had somebody have a water hose on my mask. Another thing we would do is we'd have them fill up their mask. So if this is the inside of the, called the CTT, or the combat training tank, we'd have the students line up around the outside of it with their head facing the water, roll over, fill their mask up, and then flip and have their head tilted back so the water is going up their nose from their mask because they're doing flutter kicks. And I don't know, it wasn't called drown proofing though. Those are just like remediation exercises.
But that's a horrible experience. I think
when it goes down your nose?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the reason that I kind of got a little bit of experience with it was not from being a Green Beret. It was actually because when I got out, I felt like a lot of guys, oh fuck, I made a mistake.
In getting out.
Yeah. So my thing was, I was like, I gotta get back in immediately. But at this time I had my bachelor's degree, so I was like, well, let me do an officer thing and let me try and make a more informed decision as far as what choice. So I chose Air Force, Special Tactics Officer.
Interesting.
Yeah, I was like, you know what? Air Force Officer, Special Operations. I was like, somehow that's like the trifecta. And based on previous experience, that seems like a smart move. I talked to a CCT buddy who said it was not, but
yeah,
he was like, dude, you're gonna be on a desk.
It's accurate.
But anyway, so as I was going through their process, that's when they started doing what I consider drown proofing. And it's like the breath hold swims,
yep,
the hose and the fucking
pool
mask.
Evolutions. Yep. Yeah. Okay.
So it's pool evolutions. Is that what it's called?
How many packets of noodles would you guys cook at a time?
Dude, it's just so you know,
I'm fascinated by the volume.
Yeah, the recipe calls for is 100 people.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, so, but think about that, like 100 people, you're cooking this stuff, you could make it to where, and this is probably where it goes wrong, is we make it on a small scale and it tastes pretty good, right? Like you could probably make this taste pretty good. But when you're cooking it 100 people and then I'm storing it in a fucking warmer. All right, so now I'm gonna season the beef. We're gonna take some soy sauce. Exact measurements are like this.
Yep, of course. That was exactly 1 tablespoon. Yep. I mean, again, if you go do this at scale, do you just throw that entire thing into the recipe? Into the cauldron?
Yeah, throw it in the cauldron. And then good luck how it tastes.
Yeah.
And then we'll throw some garlic salt in there. That's what the recipe calls for. About that much.
Yeah.
There.
A pinch, a dash, if you will.
And if you think that your cooks aren't doing this, I mean, let's be honest. So ground ginger, and then we'll do some salt and some pepper. Pepper that biash up. Some salt, you know? Here, there we go. Oops. Should we twist? Let's get a twist on there.
You're the chef.
Let's stack it.
So I'm gonna be honest, this looks better than the yakisoba you're gonna get at a DFAC. Like this is varsity level yakisoba. I've never seen anything like this. So I asked, you know, this afternoon, evening meal, this is gonna be heavy. Most people wouldn't think that this product right here, twisted tea,
nice,
would pair well with this. But this isn't, again, a heavy afternoon / evening meal. This comes in a convenient single serving size for whoever you are. If you open it, that's 1 serving. Again, aerate with the pour. Don't buy an extra piece of gear. Just move your hand farther away from the glass.
There you go.
You know, slight asterisk to that is that you're probably gonna spill everywhere, but that's okay, right?
You need to let people know.
Same thing, so we'll let it settle.
Okay.
Just because I'm pretty sure this beverage is tea of some kind filtered through a jock strap, so it might have some sediment at the bottom. Right?
Ooh, it smells like pure sugar.
I know, look at the legs, which doesn't actually have any.
What are legs? Can you explain?
Legs is basically from a wine product. This reminds me more of like, where I grew up in Santa Cruz is a place called the Boardwalk, and right next to it, there's like a sewage river that goes out into the ocean, and when the waves break on it, there's like a nice foam on top that's really reminding me of what the top of this,
seen this
beverage is looking like. It's really, it just sticks to it. Semi-viscous.
Yeah.
Nah, can't see through it, which is really bizarre for a tea.
I feel like like a really, have you ever, oh, this is what it reminds me of. I had rhabdo once.
And this looks like your urine.
I swear this is what my urine looked like when I had, when I peed after a severe bout of rhabdo.
Sugar on a leaf or like the inside of a sweaty eye patch?
Mm.
It's what it smells like.
Little have you had Dan Crenshaw on your podcast?
I have.
Dan? Oh, we're not drinking this? I already drank it.
Go for it. You want to aerate it in the mouth a little bit. That is pure, pure sugar. Fermented sugar with a little bit more sugar put on top. That's good. Yeah. Now we got to see, though, how it goes with the yakisoba. We forgot to eat. So, since you made this, and these are not fucking MREs, it's not good.
This is probably the white trash kicking in on me.
It is.
This is right up my alley. Don't touch the rest of that twisted tea. I will take care of it. Mm.
So this yakisoba has the same flavor profile of the one that I was used in the military.
Oh.
It would be really, really defined by its blandness. Its lack of anything nutritious.
Mm. Yeah. Did you get some meat in there with some of that? Did you get a pepper?
I did.
Mm-hmm. Usually the pepper it's not going to be like this. You're going to have that pepper in a couple hours, which it
gives it time to turn into a noodle.
It really like enhances. And then the noodles, you see how they're nice. And if you just get a close up on the noodles, they actually look moist. I know a lot of people don't like that word moist, but that's something you're not going to get in the defect. The noodles really have a chance to dry up, if you will, and then the meat, the noodles get so dry that the meat actually sticks to it. And it's quite disgusting. But let's see how it tastes now.
Go for it. And then don't forget to pair it.
Okay. That's wildly
bland.
Yeah.
Tasteless, that soulless,
uneventful,
anticlimactic. It's like a.
Maybe this will help.
It's like a middle-aged stripper, just empty inside.
I felt sorry for her when you said that.
I just speak from the heart. Sometimes it comes to me. I really like the head of it, though. Like I said, the sewage slash ocean combination.
I can feel the cavities forming. That's it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you're ever gonna jump into some yakisoba flavorless noodles, do yourself a favor and pair it with twisted tea. You'll never regret it.